video was produced by TRL and financed by AfCAP.
AfCAP stands for Africa Community Access Partnership. It is part of the RECAP program. RECAP standing for Research for Community Access Partnership. This is a DFID-funded program whose main objective is to carry out research on the provision of low-volume roads.
We see AfCAP as one of our big partners when looking to the rural areas. AfCAP was able to buy in our needs to promote best accessibility to the rural areas through low-volume roads. So we see AfCAP as one of our big and important partners on development of rural roads.
The footage and content of the video, including the research, was directed by engineer Kenneth Mukura of TRL and carried out in collaboration with the National Road Administration of Mozambique, ANE. Some of the video footage was produced in Uganda in collaboration with the Mount Elgon Labor-Based Training Center, MELTEC, of the Ministry of Works and Transport. Many developing countries, particularly in Africa and Asia, have unique demographics where 70 to 80% of national populations live in rural areas. In addition, the socio-economic development of these communities is highly dependent on the provision of reliable transport infrastructure and services. Developing nations are therefore faced with the daunting task of providing affordable and sustainable road networks to service these communities. On the other hand, financial resources are limited and generally scarce. This documentary provides an insight into the provision of low-volume roads, covering the principles, innovations in designs, and construction methods for pavements and surfacings, with case studies of trials carried out as part of an extensive research initiative. Low-volume roads are lowly trafficked roads carrying less than 300 vehicles per day, or up to a million equivalent standard axles, the latter taking precedence. It is also important to highlight the principles governing the design and construction of low-volume roads. Firstly, low-volume roads should be fit for the purpose. What this means is that they should be designed for low traffic, and this influences their geometry and pavement structures. Secondly, they should follow the existing terrain as much as possible. When upgrading existing roads, the new alignment should follow the existing alignment as much as practicable. The main principle is that the designs are tailor-made for the locally available materials, as opposed to providing materials which suit the design, as is the case with conventional design approaches. The outcome of this approach is to minimize the cost of construction and maintenance of low-volume roads, which makes them more viable.
Tem assim, os 7 km foram cerca de 27 milhões de meticais, nos 7 km, e isso corresponde a cerca de 91 mil dólares por quilómetro, mais ou menos.
Now we shall look at some of the innovations which have been developed, including the construction techniques. The innovations covered in this video include blended bases, blended wearing courses for unpaved roads, armored bases, emulsion treated bases, and unstabilized or neat sand bases for paved roads. We shall now look at each one in detail. Blended bases. Blended bases are produced by mixing two or more different materials which individually would not meet the requirements of the intended pavement layers, particularly base courses. However, when the materials are mixed in the right proportions, the blend may be of better quality than the constituent materials separately. Trials were carried out in the Inyambani province of Mozambique, where gravels which meet conventional specifications for bases are locally unavailable and could only be sourced from areas approximately 200 to 300 kilometers away. Deposits of highly plastic concrete with plasticity indices in excess of 27 and CBRs less than 10% were found locally. Sand is locally available in abundance. Through lab investigations, A design mix of 50-50 for sand and plastic concrete was produced, and it gave a CBR strength of 40-60%, which met the minimum CBR requirement for base courses on low volume roads of 40%. The trial sections were constructed and have performed very well for over 5 years, despite the harsh tropical storms experienced in the area. Blended wearing courses. The design and construction of blended wearing courses is similar to the construction of blended bases, with the exception that the blended material should be plastic in order to improve bonding and durability. Armored bases. Armored bases are produced through the construction of base course with weak materials in the case where materials which meet specifications cannot be obtained within economic hull distances. The material may be in situ or imported from borrow pits. The weak base is then armored by hammering a layer of aggregate into the surface of the base course. The aggregate is then hauled and sprayed. The aggregate may also be sprayed mechanically with a grader. Water shall be sprinkled over the aggregate to aid combustion. The aggregate is then rolled into the base course using heavy vibratory steel rollers operating at high amplitude. The aggregate should be compacted to refusal, and care should be taken to avoid shoving or overcrushing of the aggregate. More water should be sprinkled before applying the final 2-3 passes of the roller. The product is an armored base which is 100-200% stronger than the same base course without armoring. In this trial, locally available concrete aggregate was used to armor the weak red sand base. The application rate for the armoring aggregate was 26 to 30 liters per square meter. After construction, the armored base layer looked like normal coarse gravel. The advantages of the armored bases include high strength, high resilience against washaways during flooding, and it also amalgamates the base and the surfacing, thus creating log-life surfacings. In this approach, the base becomes part of the surfacing and the surfacing becomes part of the base, thus avoiding a plane interface between the surfacing and the base. Emulsion-treated bases. Emulsion-treated bases, also known as ETBs, are constructed through the stabilization of weak base materials with bitumen emulsion. Bitumen emulsion is a suspension of bitumen droplets in water aided by the addition of an emulsifying agent. There are different types of bitumen emulsions, namely slow setting emulsion SS60 and SS70, medium setting emulsion MS60 and MS70, and rapid setting emulsion RS60 and RS70. Slow setting emulsion is recommended for the construction of ETBs. ETBs can be constructed using three different construction methods, namely labor-based methods, intermediate technology, and plant mix, which is high-tech. Labor-based technology. Labor-based technology involves the extraction of materials by labor using hand tools, transportation using tractor-trailer combinations, dumping, and spreading. The emulsion may be added using watering cans or a tractor-towed binder distributor with a hand lens or tractor-towed bowser with spray bar. After spreading adequate emulsion, the material and the emulsion are mixed with a disc harrow attached to a tractor. The mixing should be thorough and quick until the ETB is homogeneous. The ETB is then sprayed by laborers using hand tools and compacted. The ETB shall be protected from traffic for at least 5 days before applying the surfacing. Intermediate technology. The material is sprayed using graders, watered, and mixed until the moisture is slightly lower than the optimum moisture content. Emulsion is sprayed, followed immediately by mixing of the emulsion and material using a disc harrow attached to a tractor. The tractor should drive at a high speed to churn out the material adequately. After mixing, the base layer is leveled, shaped, and compacted with small to medium-sized rollers. The ETB is then cured for at least 5 days before the application of surfacing. Plant mix. The material and emulsion are mixed in a mixing plant similar to a fixed concrete plant or a mobile mixer. The ETB is then transported to the road, spread and compacted. A paver can be used for laying the ETB. If the material is very fine, the speed of traverse of the paver should be set out at 1 meter per minute. The ETB is then rolled using light to medium-sized rollers and allowed to cure for at least 5 days before applying surfacing. In this case, very fine sand with nominal maximum sizes of 2 mm was used for the construction of ETB, and this sand does not meet conventional specifications which require a nominal maximum size of 19 mm and would under normal circumstances be rejected. Innovative designs were developed and tested in the lab, and trial sections of different proportions of emulsion and cement filler were used. The ETB was also constructed to different thicknesses from 50 mm to 100 mm. Sand bases. Recent research by TRL has shown that sand can be used without stabilization for the construction of road base even in areas of adverse climatic conditions. There are several types of sand which include grayish and white sands which are generally non-plastic, and red sand which is slightly plastic and cohesive. The latter is preferred in the construction of road bases. Research was carried out and trial sections constructed where neat sand was used for the construction of base course. Penetration macadam surfacing was constructed on the neat sand base, and the sections have performed very well over a period of 5 years without any signs of distress despite the tropical storms experienced during this period. Surfacing. When the road base is completed and approved, priming and the construction of surfacing follows. There are different types of surfacing, and these include bituminous seals such as surface dressing, otter seal, cape seal, sand seal, slurry seal, penetration macadam, cold mix asphalt, emulsion-based otter seals or graded aggregate seals, and thick sand seals or cold sand asphalt. Surfacing can also be discrete, such as block paving and brick paving. Surface dressing. Surface dressing is also called a chip seal. Bitumen is heated to the required temperature and sprayed on the primed base. Alternatively, emulsions may be used to construct surface dressings. Aggregate is applied, followed immediately by rolling. Otter seal. Otter seal involves the application of binder and graded aggregate, which can be natural or crushed. The natural aggregate could be quartz, laterite, or calcrete, or any other type as long as it meets the specification requirements. Bitumen is then heated and sprayed on the primed base, followed by the application of the aggregate. In this case, the design involved the use of weak concrete aggregate with an aggregate crushing value of 27 to 30, where the conventional maximum limit is 24, and of a nominal maximum size of 13 mm instead of the conventional nominal maximum size of 19 mm. The aggregates also had high dust and fine content, with percentage finer than 0.075 millimeters of 13%, where the conventional limit is 10%. The application of the bitumen MC3000 was varied to include trial sections with 1.2, 1.4, 1.6, 1.8, 2.0, and 2.4 liters per square meter. The aggregate was applied at the conventional rate of 16 liters per square meter. The otter seal is then rolled for 5 days, and completed sections can be opened to traffic 3 days after construction. Traffic aids curing of the otter seal. When the otter seal is properly cured, it should turn black as a result of the binder migrating to the surface. The trial sections were monitored for 5 years, and sections with binder application rates of 1.2 and 1.4 liters per square meter developed potholes, but sections with application rates of 1.6 to 2.5 liters per square meter were still in good condition. Alternatively, otter seal can be constructed in the form of a double seal or single otter seal with sand caping, or single otter seal with grit seal, or single otter seal with slurry caping. Single otter seal with slurry caping produces a fine finish and is very durable. It is, however, more expensive on capital cost but cheap in life cycle cost terms. Cap seal. Cap seal is a single surface dressing with a slurry caping. This surfacing is constructed in the same manner as the otter seal with slurry caping. Cap seal is highly durable and can be used on high volume roads. It is expensive in capital costs compared to single or double surface dressing, but it is cheaper in life cycle terms and also provides a smooth ride. Sand seal. Sand seal involves the spraying of binder followed by the application of sand, which can be natural or quarry sand. The base is swept clean, followed by a light application of water. The binder is then heated and sprayed on the primed base. Alternatively, emulsion can be used for the construction of sand seals. Emulsions are preferred when the sand is very fine. Sand is immediately sprayed on the hot binder and rolled for 3 days. Slurry seal. Slurry is a mixture of aggregate, cement, water, and emulsion SS60 in proportions given in the design. The aggregate can be coarse and natural or quarry sand and should be clean. In this case, slurry was mixed in a mobile mixing plant and sprayed immediately to levels. The mixed proportions are adjusted on the plant controls, and the thickness of the slurry is set by adjusting the height of the box above the surface of the primed base. The thickness should be no less than 5 mm, and ideally it should be 10 mm or 15 mm thick, in which case it should be applied in 2 layers. Alternatively, slurry can be mixed in a concrete mixer. The slurry can be applied using labor-based methods and sprayed with rubber squeegees and smoothed with wet hessian cloth. Penetration macadam. Penetration macadam involves the application of binder and aggregate in 2 or 3 layers. Conventionally, 3 crushed stone applications are made. The first layer of aggregate size of 40 to 60 millimeters or 50 to 70 millimeters or 60 to 80 millimeters. The second layer of 10 to 20 millimeters aggregate size, and the third and final layer of 5 to 10 millimeters aggregate size. This is followed by the application of hot bitumen at a rate of 6 liters per square meter. This is very expensive but also very durable. In this case, a different and innovative design was developed, which involved only 2 layers of weak concrete and limestone aggregate. The first layer of aggregate size 20 to 40 millimeters and the second layer of 5 to 30 millimeters aggregate size. Emulsion SS60 was used instead of hot cut bed or penetration binders. The application rate of binder was varied on the trial sections with binder application rates of 1.6, 1.8, 2, and 3 liters per square meter, followed by rolling with a steel drum roller in non-vibratory mode. The wheels should be weighted to avoid pickup of the surfacing. The surfacing should be cured for 4 to 5 days before opening to traffic. The penetration macadam surfacing was in good condition after 4 years of service, and is so robust that it is likely to last for a very long time without the need for maintenance. This penetration macadam is relatively very cheap with much less binder. It was constructed on unstabilized sand base and the road has performed very well. Cold mix asphalt. Cold mix asphalt is a mixture of emulsion and graded aggregate with a nominal maximum size of 13 millimeters. Sometimes, a filler of fine inerte material can be added to improve consistency and strength. The aggregate should meet the grading specifications and the binder should be SS60 emulsion. In order to ensure correct batching of the cold mix asphalt, a trial mix should be carried out. This procedure involves weighing of the constituents of the cold mix, where the residual binder should be 7% of the aggregate by mass. The two are mixed and the cold mix asphalt is then laid and rolled. The cold mix asphalt should be checked for consistency and compactness. A trial section was constructed and the cold mix asphalt was mixed in a mobile plant and laid using a paver. Thinner layers of 25 to 30 millimeters should be applied on low volume roads in order to minimize costs. The cold mix asphalt was then compacted and cured for 48 hours. Alternatively, labor-based methods of construction of cold mix asphalt can be used. These involve cleaning and marking of the primed base, spotting of aggregate, aiding emulsion, and mixing. Once the mix is homogeneous, the cold mix asphalt is then sprayed, guided by side rails, and rolled with a minimum of 8 passes of a steel drum in non-vibratory mode or a pneumatic roller. Traffic may be allowed on the surfacing after 48 hours. Thick sand seal or cold sand asphalt. Sand seals are a cheap alternative in the construction of lowly trafficked roads. Nevertheless, they tend to be very thin and less durable. TRL initiated research in the construction of sand seals to try and construct them in thicker layers. The procedure involves setting out, cleaning of the primed base, spraying of 30% binder, spreading of sand, spraying of the second application of the remaining 70% binder, and application of the second layer of sand. The sand seal is then rolled by applying 8 passes of a steel roller in non-vibratory mode or a pneumatic roller. It is easier for emulsion to penetrate downward into the layer of sand than upwards as it is with the conventional approach. Using this method, a thicker sand seal can be constructed. If the process is repeated 2 or 3 times, a thick sand seal can be constructed and it will become cold sand asphalt. This is much more durable than the normal sand seal. Emulsion-based water seals. Through research and innovation, TRL developed an emulsion-based water seal in which the binder is applied at ambient temperature. The procedure involves cleaning and marking the primed base, spraying 30% of the emulsion, spreading the aggregate, and spraying the remaining 70% of the emulsion. Once the emulsion has broken, the water seal is rolled with 8 passes of the pneumatic roller. The section may be open to traffic after 48 hours. Emulsion-based water seal or grated aggregate seal has many advantages. 1. The emulsion is applied at ambient temperature and is therefore safe for labor-based operations. 2. There is no need for prolonged rolling, which is required for water seal constructed using hot binders. And 3. In the conventional methods, a lot of aggregate remains unbound and is usually lost, whereas with this new method, all the aggregate is bound and none is lost. Challenges. The challenges that are generally encountered in the provision of low-volume roads include lack of good or suitable road building materials, lack of capacity in the private sector, lack of suitable equipment.
Looking up to the fact of 80% of the network is not covered, it is easy to conclude that funding levels are not up to date. There is also urgent need to pave the road network and also to implement the periodic maintenance and rehabilitation of the road whose funding levels are low.
Despite these challenges, many notable achievements have been witnessed.
The let us just look for the materials that we have in each province, and let us just design those engineering solutions. And then we implemented phase one, phase two, phase three, and fourth, and the last phase, a great success.
O impacto desse projeto em Moçambique é bastante positivo, na medida em que as estradas passam a ser transitadas ao longo de todo o ano, sem interrupção durante a época chuvosa, entretanto com ganhos, grandes ganhos em termos de tempo de viagem, em termos do custo de operação dos veículos. Para a comunidade local, os benefícios são inúmeros. A comunidade local pode acessar facilmente a serviços como hospitais, escolas, mercados e outros serviços públicos. E em zonas com algum potencial agrícola, podemos também ver que a economia melhorou. A economia melhorou com a redução da pobreza da população, uma vez que os pequenos agricultores conseguem escoar os seus produtos ao longo de todo o ano aos mercados mais próximos. Thank you.